During the 1960s, the moment when the steady exodus of islanders who migrated to mainland cities in search of opportunity seemed to have the greatest impact on her community, Cornelia decided to stay and fight. In her memoir, God, Dr. Buzzard, and the Bolito Man, she explained that she didn't put roots down on Sapulpa to become a leader. She simply desired to live among her kinfolk. Yet, she also noted that the movements of the 50s and the 60s touched her. Quote, "The civil rights movement had changed the way that I saw things," end quote. She was no stranger to racism, but she was troubled by the fact that the Voting Rights and Civil Rights Act did not change life on Sapulpa. Old racial paradigms were still at play. Quote, "People were afraid to voice their opinion about anything for fear that they would get fired, for fear that they wouldn't be allowed to ride the boat between Sapulpa and the mainland anymore, and fear that repercussions would be taken out on their family," end quote. Gradually, Cornelia looked to the lessons learned during the civil rights years and invoked them. She wrote, quote, "The civil rights movement had made us realize that you can oppose someone powerful, and not only that, sometimes you can even win," end quote. Doing all that she could to stave off predatory developers and to promote Sapulpa's history and culture, she emerged as a leader in her community. In her memoir, Cornelia describes her mission as one that weaves together storytelling, Black history, and land protection strategies. Quote, "I tell our stories to help the folks on Sapulpa keep our history alive, to help us take pride in the past, and to help us gain strength for the future. Because I know if our ancestors could get through everything they did and keep going, we could face anything that comes our way. I speak out for our culture wherever I'm asked to, from universities to elementary schools. I speak out through the newspaper. I speak out in TV interviews. And when family and relatives come home, I go to work," end quote. And for Cornelia, going to work often meant fighting to revive and secure her community. When the Atlanta Journal-Constitution interviewed her following her book's publication, she warned about the threats Sapulpa's lone surviving Black community faced. Quote, "All we have left is Hawk Hammock. If we've lost about 20 acres of it to people from outside the community, we can't let our guard down for 1 minute because so many people want our land," end quote. She had been active in the land fight since 1975, when she was one among the group who founded the Hawk Hammock Community Foundation to oppose a land sale that was rumored to push Blacks off the island. They won that fight, but challenges continue to emerge in the community. For decades, Cornelia used her voice to protect her community. And when new property assessments resulted in dramatic increases in the islanders' taxes in 2013, she reminded reporters and officials about the true value of their land. She told the NPR reporter, quote, "I don't care what anybody, what they consider an assessed value on my land that my people struggled so hard to buy a long time ago after the Civil War. There is no value on it. It's priceless. To us, it's priceless. This is our history, our heritage, and our birthright," end quote. Cornelia never missed an opportunity to tell the world and remind descendants what they would lose if they sold away their land. In 2008, in an interview with NPR, she said, quote, "Yeah, people are being offered large amounts of money for it, and some people are selling it because they don't think anything of it. They're selling our cultural history, and they're selling our birthright," end quote. The birthright that Cornelia consistently talked about, it was not an easily acquired inheritance. It was an endowment that newly freed men and freed women fought for. She knew how hard it was for her ancestors to get and keep land. So she valued the sanctity of the Black community. She envisioned a revived Sapulpa that maintained a Black majority, a racial composition that mirrored the free community that they built after the Civil War. She told a New York Times reporter in 2008, quote, "I would rather my community be all Black," end quote. She says she responds to whites looking to buy land by saying, quote, "My land is for my children, my grandchildren, and even for the She understood the ways that racism and internalized racism contributed to the Islanders' predicament and undermined her vision of a vibrant, resurrected, and Black Acadia. Quote, "We still think that the white person has more money, so we offer land to the white person before we offer it to our own people. I'd rather have it the other way around. Black folks with the same type of culture and history to purchase it." End quote. Most of the attention paid to Sappho revolves around culture, but Cornelia argued that efforts to preserve the Islanders' culture should never be separated from efforts to preserve Black property ownership. In one interview, she offered a definition of Gullah culture that tied land and cultural traditions together. Quote, "Well, the Geechee culture consists of people, their dialect, or sometimes people refer to as their language, their way of life, the way they express themselves, and it always centers around land. Your culture is no good if you don't have land. So we're holding on to the land so that we can hold on to culture and history at the same time." End quote. She had a vision for how to hold on to culture, land, and history at the same time. As one of Sackville Island's revitalization and cultural society's founding members, Sycars, she championed the development of a land trust for descendants. Cornelia also had a vision for Sackville's future that involved the return of descendants. And some people believe that the development of Black-owned tourist industries is a viable solution to the problems that coastal communities like Sackville face. But Cornelia understood that tourism produced consequences that exacted a heavy toll on Blacks living in communities like Ilmenau. Cornelia owned land, and she ran a bed and breakfast, but she was very clear about the limits of tourism. She told one reporter, quote, "We want everyone to visit Sappho. We just don't want them putting down roots here." And she put her energy into projects and collaborations that she hoped would restore her community's vitality. She worked with Sycars in projects like the Cultural Day Festival. She looked to the island's agricultural past to resuscitate the island's economy. She was an important partner in efforts to grow heirloom sugarcane and cultivate Sappho red peas. No matter how grim prospects for her community's future appeared, Cornelia was steadfast, and she motivated her comrades to remain steadfast. At a community meeting in 2009, she said, quote, "We're surviving because we're survivors. We have the harshest thing called slavery, and we survived it," end quote. A reminder that served to inspire and connect the travails of the past with the trials of the present. As Black communities across the country fight to survive gentrification and dislocation, may they look to activists like Cornelia Walker Vail, Sackville's treasure, light, and glory to shore up.
Even though I was in another state, I found out over the years how much the same thing happened to so many of us who can now say the words Gullah and Geechee, or now Gullah and Geechee as one word, identifying but one culture, because we are all the one same people. And then through that, it was a matter of what I learned from Cornelia Bailey, even long before I met her. And because she exemplified a life that moved beyond the culture shame. You know, those living on the islands who endured this for decades before even use of Gullah and Geechee, and those names that were in some ways we thought of were outsiders calling us. And then this cultural group from South Carolina identified as Gullah, and to identify the language, you know, how researchers and outsiders would say. And then Geechee was identified in Georgia as looking at the word used for the people. And so we all consider this a pejorative term. And, you know, especially Geechee would lead to, you know, like, you know, say, don't call me about Geechee. And that has changed in recent years, just in recent years. And we're still working on educating people within the culture that it's okay to say Gullah and Geechee, or not even Gullah and Geechee. And so the recognition of the culture as, you know, distinct, you know, the thing is that we're catching up on how long ago people have been curious about these people. And so especially since the 2006 congressional law that connected the southern part of North Carolina and then South Carolina, Georgia, and the northern part of Florida, close to 30 miles in, and identifying these folks who were from very specific ethnic groups who retained so much of cultural identity that can be linked to origins in West Africa. We had no idea our retention of those ethnic behaviors, those cultural behaviors, the language. And that's, this is what I see in Cornelia, in that because she sat with the elders and learned this without shame. And so I learned from Cornelia Bailey that to move into space of your culture and identity without shame is something that I took years, and is still taking many others in the culture to accept and be that identity. So it's the two words together that we now acknowledge as the one people, because we link to the rice coast of West Africa as from southern Senegambia to northern Liberia, and also includes Angolans. And so each in turn has its own cultural, evolution on the coasts. Because it is where Europeans could not grow rice. So they, some people in some recent books said that, free labor who came over to help with the grow rice. The ones who really came over in the bellies of ships chained and such like that to grow rice that was indigenous to that location in West Africa. So this is the thing where I see that being, not calling myself Gullah Geechee is relatively new. And growing up in culture shame, and it's a term that I figured out how to use, maybe in the 80s, 90s and such, is something that, you know, Cornelia Bailey was able to move through, you know, her personal strength to know the culture and learn the ways of the elders was a part of growing up. And because you learn from the elders, you know, and from the, without understanding what it is that you are learning, what it is that they're passing on. And so culture shame was a suppression of culture. It was a shaming of outsiders, or even being made fun of by those across the bridge, you know, in town, in black or white. because, you know, pointing fingers at us and telling folks to watch out for them people because, you know, they're cool people, you know. They can put a spell on you. And our parents, my parents wanted, you know, so many of our people on the islands and such, parents wanted us to succeed, so we didn't speak the language. We suppressed who we were. We minimized our cultural behavior, especially when we went into town, and then we would become this ourselves, playing with kids and playing with the elders, being with ourselves, and then we would move off to the in town and we mimic that King's English, that New England English, in a speech pattern that was not comfortable, but we knew we had to use it. And it became confusing to people because we always asked, and said, where are you from?
Where are you from? Are you from Boston? You sound as if you are from some
island somewhere. I said, yeah, I'm from the island. So no matter, you know, wanting to hide our culture, we retained a lot of what we learned. And this is what I have been coming out with for myself and remembering all the parts of sitting with the elders and going back into my mind, my memory about what the elders taught, what sitting with my grandmother and, you know, and learned in that just transgenerational type of behavior and what these plants out in the pond was all about. And she'd send us over here and we do our own healing. And our group at a time where there was only one white doctor in the whole entire county who wouldn't even see anyone black. So between my mother's mail order medical book and my grandmother, who was a midwife, sending us out and pick this weed, this thing, that poultice, to make poultice, you do the thing, we were healthy. Because that's the way we learned how not only to survive, but it was a transition, it was a retention of knowing what worked. So that's where you learn the games, you hear the songs, you learn the ways of living in the culture, because in that, it also is a retention and a link to the West African groups. You see, and then I met Cornelia Bailey, because I heard about her. I heard about this woman who sat on the island, her mom, right? She was like, oh my gosh, this is, because I'm comfortable with who I am. And I saw this person who learned the ways of the culture, the ways of walking the land, and learning from the elders about being Gullah Geechee, although we didn't know what it meant. But we learned how to all of a sudden identify ourselves. No one knew at that time that we were all going to a non-consonant until now, until recent years. So much of what I took for granted, I now say, call yourself who you are. You're Gullah Geechee. And so Cornelia Bailey is a living example, that became a living example of how to move through culture shame. And I recognize myself the commonality of the cultural behavior and accept the knowledge of living from the land. And I no longer suppress my language and I code switch freely. It was an ease that was not possible years ago. So I became comfortable in those visits to Sapelo Island and riding the roads and the Sapelo bus upon. They're very specific. I mean, anything that is over there that's larger than the refrigerator has to come over on the barge. You know, so, anyway, and that's a whole other story. So those are special rides, bouncing up and down the roads and going back into places outsiders know a little about. And there's always joy and light in Cornelia Bailey's face. This is home, and this is the way of the life of people. And I no longer suppress what I learned from the elders, and the same way that Cornelia Bailey learned from her elders. And I learned that being Gullah Geechee is living a culture, and that Cornelia Bailey was a champion of that life.
to people who were enslaved here in North Carolina and in South Carolina. My people came from Cabarrus County in South of there and Lexington County, and in South Carolina, Lancaster County, Fairfield County, York County. And I've always loved my family history, and I knew my genealogy, my family was into that. But when I met Cornelia, she taught me a different way of looking at my family. I began to see things about my family that I hadn't noticed before. I met her in 2001. I was a newspaper writer for the Florida Times Union in Jacksonville, Florida. And I used to write features columns and stories, and every once in a while I would do book reviews. And so one day, someone left a copy of her book that I got the Buzzard and the Molito Man on my desk. To this day, I have no idea who put it there. But it was fate, because I read the book, and I was just knocked out a quick book review. This sounds interesting. But I became obsessed with that book. And it was only an hour away, and I was mad at myself because I had never been there before and didn't know anything about it. So I talked to my editor, and she went along with my plans to allow me to go there for a weekend to write my story. And so, like probably thousands of journalists before me and thousands after me, I dropped in on the weekend and wrote my story about this David Goliath story of black people fighting for their land. And, you know, it just seemed very cut and clear, black and white. And I thought that was that. And I went home. And but the island kept calling to me. The beaches and the serenity of it, you know, it just became a place that I would go to relax and spend time with my family. And over time, I started developing this friendship with Cornelia Bailey. The first time I went and stayed at her lodge, you know, we went and set out, when I went as a tourist and not as a reporter, we went and set out under the gazebo and talked. And then the next time I went, you know, she told me, well, you can just leave some of your stuff here, because I have a feeling you're going to be back. And so she allowed, you know, me to put my stuff up in the attic so that I wouldn't have to haul my stuff every time I came. And then eventually she quit picking me up at the dock, and she just leave a car for me and told me I could just drive myself in. And, you know, we became friends, and we started this conversation that would last for 12 years. Just every now and then, get together and talk. Over time, I met someone on the island, and I did eventually marry someone from South Florida. But I never forgot the conversations that we had in when I was a tourist, because there was one conversation in particular that stood out to me, and it was one in which she told me that, you know, this is your history too. This is your story too. You know, this is your culture. And I didn't understand that because I'm not Gullah-Geechee. You know, I don't have any roots to the islands. But after moving to the island and talking to her and understanding the history more and getting to know the people, I began to see what she meant. For her, the struggle that they were going through on the Sabalo to move on to the land was a universal struggle. And I began to see in my own family, you know, that my ancestors had owned land. I had an ancestor in Mecklenburg County who owned over 300 acres, one down in South Carolina who owned over 300 acres. And I watched as the last of my North Carolina ancestors' land was sold to a developer or made into a subdivision, you know, and felt helpless thinking about it because there was no Cornelia in our family. There wasn't a community there. It was just land that, you know, one of my cousins decided to sell. So I began to see this universal theme that was happening on Sabalo within the families there. I also began to see that it wasn't a black and white issue or a David and Goliath issue. You know, these are families. And like Melissa was saying, you know, there are family members that are selling their land. And how do you convince them of the value of that land and what went into getting that land? And how do you convince them that, you know, somebody's offering you this much money that you've never seen in your life, that could change your life, set you up for a comfortable retirement, or send your children to college? How do you make them realize that there may be other ways for them to accomplish those goals without selling out, you know, selling off their birthright, their heritage? So these are conversations that we had, and ever since she passed away, I've been hearing her voice in my head and trying to figure out what we can do going forward. At her funeral, someone walked up to me and said, you know, Cornelia's gone now. Who's going to take her place? You know, who's the next Cornelia? Are you going to do it? Are you going to be the person to step up? You know, I'm like, no. The whole point of her constantly talking to people and telling the story and pleading with descendants to hold on to their land and pleading with people of like mind to come and
not going to ever be another chameleon. There's not going to be one person to do this. And it never should have been one person doing it. It should have been all of us doing this all along. You know, so I hope that through this event and hope more to come, you know, we'll continue to plant the seeds of what she did and hopefully inspire the next generation to find as passionately as she did on the way.
So some of the things we've been working on Sappho, Michelle said, nobody ever filled me in their shoe. Right now, I'm a person, I put my foot in a shoe, but I know people will feel it. I've never. But we're working on a bee project on Sappho, so my mother started planting bee on Sappho here at the old side parts. So we're now bringing that back to Sappho. After 2 weeks ago, we got 100 bees on Sappho. We also, doing the sugar cane. We get into wide scale pregnant sugar cane. We'll be working with Davidson College and the University of Georgia system to pregnant crops on Sappho. And besides those,
Okay, we got the stop sign. We'll all be available around for more conversation. Thank you so much.